four, three.
Really is intelligent life out there.
Well, let's start by finding out. Company seeks applicants willing to work in poor conditions with little financial remuneration. Salesman, negotiable. Door-to-door salesman required by Bulgarian Screwdrivers, Inc. Suitable for friendly outgoing people with private means.
What would actually happen if an extraordinary genius was at loose in society without access to power, money, or institutions? Anode Enzyme is a genius with an IQ of 12,794, master of all trades, jack of none. His impeccable psychic architecture is marred by a single flaw. He's got no money. He resolves to rectify this circumstance.
Sir, may I have your attention?
No. My attention is not something to be given or lent, but for keeping to myself and cherishing during the long quiet of my aloneness.
I am Lord Doberman, the richest man in the world, and I require the services of a genius. Do you know where I can find one?
I am a genius.
Now, what form does your genius take?
I can repair a chronometer wearing motorcyclist gloves.
Nice. What else?
At present, I'm working on an international language based on numbers. I got the idea from a Chinese restaurant.
Interesting. What would a Rolls Royce be?
356.
A month in the Bahamas?
1,287.
A zinc bradawl?
33,492/17.
And what might number one be?
Money. Library I could use?
Yes, I have 17.
It's common knowledge, and we're quite rightly taught from childhood onwards, that money can't buy happiness. And that those unfortunate enough to have been saddled with this burden are haunted by guilt, insecurity, and the constant threat of madness.
My grandfather, worried about the way the language was deteriorating, had a special library built to house the finest examples available. The only writing you could find to his liking was that used on the bill sent by the gas, electricity, and telephone companies prior to cutting off these services. He had them bound in alum tarred pigskin. Well, the records start from 1911 to the present day. We have 25,000 telephones in Mollusk Hall. Here's a nice 23 gas reminder.
What I'm looking for is the Geneva report on plastic fatigue.
In a bathroom at Mollusk Hall, Lord Doberman, the richest man in the world, interrupts Anode Enzyme genius as he's trimming his beard with an hydroelectric shaver fashioned from a discarded tape recorder and a clockwork pig.
Conserving energy. You're not putting your genius to full use.
I've been so busy working on the secret of life.
Could you lay that aside and start thinking about money?
What have you in mind?
My fortune 6 minutes ago was 982,000 British billions. I'm at a loss in knowing what to do with it. I need help.
Well, I'll help you. Money is a brand new creative medium lying dormant, waiting for someone to exploit it.
Go on.
For instance, have you ever actually seen your 967,000 billions?
Not all of it.
Do you know that 300 million pounds stacked on top of each other would reach a height of 18 miles?
But they would fall over.
I have a method of overcoming that.
Good man. We'll pay a visit to my bank in the city and arrange delivery of the pounds.
Would you like the pounds in the new size, sir? My calculations were based on the old pound, but the fresh challenge of working with new pounds could be stimulating. To appreciate the complexity of assembling 3 million pounds into a continuous pile may require thinking beyond the pain threshold. I propose to erect the pile with some 30,000 of these units, each which will contain 10,000 pounds, clearly visible. The simple interlocking device can be operated by a servant. Their manufacture is at present underway in Hong Kong. The growing pile will be balanced by a series of balloons, not suspended, for at any given stage the base pound will rest firmly on the ground. In combating the vagaries of the weather, much will depend on the efficacy of my balloon design. Tomorrow, the prototype will undergo rigorous testing in the wind tunnel at Nympton. We can do nothing about the money pile until the balloons are dispatched from Hong Kong. So, in order to keep your spirits up, I have devised an entertainment which incorporates the salient features of every ball game ever invented.
Oh, good. Where?
In the guests' games room.
How do you play?
You strike this solid melamine sphere, coach bolted to the billiard table, as hard as you can with your 3-pound vanadium steel leather-faced hammer.
How do you score?
1 point for each hit.
1,135?
1,136. There's your first 100,000. The inflation appears to be stable.
Of the pounds?
No, the balloon.
Your Lordship, there's a man to see you from the tax office.
The what?
Oh, don't hit me, sir.
I wonder how they found out.
Good news travels at the speed of madness. Have you declared this money?
It's declaring itself.
Even a genius requires a rest. I'm going off on holiday to recharge my cells.
Have you any place in mind?
Yes, I'm going to the island of Obscenus, where the inhabitants communicate in language so foul that shipwrecked sailors have been known to cower helplessly behind mounds of shriveled seaweed.
No. Have you furnished yourself with a phrase book?
Naturally.
I'll translate. Yes.
This is an unusually fine violin.
Yes, it was the favorite of A. Stradivari. He never allowed it to be played.
Let's cut it up with a chainsaw.
What a brilliant idea. Let me do it.
All right, but first, I'd better secure it to the top of the pianoforte with 6-inch nails. Thank you.
rewarding. What can we do for an encore?
Let's cut up the tape recorder.
The Chinese have a saying to the effect that one picture equals 10,000 words. The British, whose good common sense precludes the extravagances of Eastern mysticism, have corrected this Oriental excess by redefining it thus: 10,000 pictures equal one word. My father's favorite story was about the time when he was a student. A friend of his was painting in a field, painting a landscape. And after a while, he sensed a presence behind him, and he looked round, and standing behind was a tall lady with a fur coat and a fur hat. She watched for a long time as he continued painting, then suddenly said, "And a big, strong man like you too," and slowly walked away.
It has long been known that fish have a more accurate sense of time than any mechanical or electronic device. Generations of scientists have dreamed that one day it would be possible to make use of this extraordinary natural phenomenon. The dream has now been realized. By coupling a piranha fish with the latest electronic technology, a degree of time accuracy hitherto unavailable is now a reality. So much so that large-scale rethinking is inevitable. A summit meeting will take place in Geneva next year to consider the impact this new concept will have on world structures. The EEC has already urged that new time, or, as it is more accurately designated, piranha time, should be adopted forthwith. I have designed a clock motivated by a tether piranha fish in pursuit of a similarly secured mesh sphere filled with caviar.
So you have. It's going fast.
So it is. I'll soon remedy that.
How?
By replacing the caviar with a fish finger.
Really must have some of this 600-year-old brandy, Anode. It has all the advantages of suicide, yet none of the side effects.
Can you appreciate the possibilities of a single piece of hardboard the size of two cricket pitches?
My God, yes. But how?
If you buy an existing hardboard factory, I'll adapt it for you.
Very thoughtful of you to modify my car so I can travel at 130 miles per hour in reverse.
I had a few moments to spare this morning, having composed the final phase of the Dance of the Stainless Steel Tadpole.
Excuse me, man in the street. Could you direct me to the Harbord factory?
No, I'm not paid to give directions. But for a monetary incentive, I could be incited to sing my way through my sinuses.
Mr. Braddle, I am Lord Doberman. I would like to purchase your hardboard factory.
My pleasure. I'll accept £300,000 cash for a quick sale.
I'll take it. The money's in the boot of my car.
Fine. Goodbye.
Mr. Chamfer, perhaps you would be so good as to show us where the hardboard is made.
Ordinarily, yes. But this factory hasn't produced any hardboard since 1949. The workforce has been on strike for 30 years.
Gentlemen, each of you will be paid £5,000 per week, if that is acceptable. You will be in the capable hands of Anode Enzyme, genius and creative hardboard director. Take over, Anode.
Hello, chaps. We're all going to use our resources to make a single piece of hardboard the size of two cricket pitches.
But the machinery's out of date for such a project.
I have designed the new machinery.
It would, like, bend in the middle. Sort of break under its own weight, as it were.
No, there is a way. It floats on a cushion of inner.
There's a house still standing. It's full of people.
People? What kind of jackanapery is this? I'll go inside and shout at them. I may even jump up and down.
Oh, good morning, sir. I'm just preparing breakfast. Would you care to join us?
Well, just a small one.
My wife left me.
I wonder why.
Have a seat, and I'll tell you. It's my birthday today. You look marvellous for a man of 70. I'm 33.
You were going to tell us why your wife left you.
Oh, yes. My wife said to me, all you really want from me is that I should be a housekeeper. Someone to wash your socks and fetch and carry for you. She then walked out and vanished forever. Of course, with that singular directness that women have, she was absolutely right. So, I did just that.
Did what?
Got myself a housekeeper. Liesl! Oh, there you are, Liesl. You will find in the scullery some socks for your attention. And, could you bring me a fresh runlet of wine from the cellar? I am Dr. Sven from Sweden.
Your project has aroused much interest in my country.
Have you met Anode Enzyme?
I know his work well. No praise is too high for a man who can fit contact lenses to an Alsatian dog without tranquilizers. Could I inspect your machinery and perhaps interview one of your staff?
Certainly.
Zimph.
What is this zimph you speak of?
It's a new word I'm trying out for a day or two.
Why not try morp?
Zimph. Zimph. Zimph, zimph. 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 Zimph.
I'd like to drink more, but my body isn't strong enough.
Present-day technology is such that I could rebuild you internally, thus enabling you to achieve a higher performance. My surgery, although rusty, is still avant-garde. Think about it.
Some other time.
In the meantime, I want you to see an interesting byproduct of my hard-bought research. These gentlemen from the factory have graciously disclaimed their lunch hour to tender assistance.
What we have. All right. March.
Goodness, what was that?
Based on the concept of a man inadvertently stepping on a garden rake, this device distributed at random throughout the country could bring a potential adversary to the brink of his reason. Made of inch-thick cast iron, it could stop a tank in its tracks.
My God, if this fell into the wrong hands.
Well, let's try not to think about it.
Milord, there's a Mr. Chamfer from the hardboard factory wishing to speak with you.
Your hardboard's ready, sir.
Not before time. Anode, the hardboard's ready.
Not before time.
We'd better go to the factory and see what they've achieved. I'll tell Sedilla. She's pressing flowers.
How clever. A melon.
What's that?
Oh, sorry, I was practicing speech at 25,000 watts per minute. I'll have to teach you speed hearing.
But what were you saying?
I was saying the 18th dimension is a possibility.
I suppose I'd better go and insure myself against being hit by a Portuguese ship at trough.
I feel terribly guilty.
Well, of course you do. It's society's best way yet of ensuring that your short stay upon this planet is made as uncomfortable as possible.
Can anything be done about it?
Maybe. I'll need a few hours in the laboratory.
There. I've isolated pure guilt.
Oh, it's horrible. Can I blast it with my shotgun?
Not yet. I want to study its properties. See if I can find an antidote. Oh, by the way, it's 500,000 times the normal dose. It must not be allowed to escape.
Unthinkable. I'll have Paxton guard the laboratory night and day.
Master, I don't quite know how to tell you this, but the guilt has escaped. Feel free to strike me a glancing blow, sir.
Where would it go?
To seek nourishment. Otherwise, it would wither and die. We must trace it. Oh, look. Look, there it is. It's feeding on that church. And it's growing bigger.
It is the Prince of Darkness!
No, Reverend. Something much worse. Guilt.
Why is it eating my church?
Don't ask me. I wouldn't know. I'm only the richest man in the world.
This morning I shouted angrily at the ceiling, then laughed at the carpets alternately in rapid succession for 10 minutes.
Nice. I've been trying to find a way of hammering a nail into a wine glass without breaking it.
Achieving that could win you an award.
I've already received the highest honor the system can bestow.
Which is?
A total unrecognition.
I hope you're not taking yourself too seriously.
Lord Doberman, I think it's maybe time I forsook your patronage and branched out on my own.
But you must realize there is no place in the outside world for a genius. How would you maintain yourself?
I'd become a private tutor and teach people to stare unseeingly at blank walls.
How could you be so commercial?
10, 9...